Sky's getting dark, and the clouds are moving in, and the storms of life fill your heart with pain. Just let the Savior in, and He will trust in Him. He will lead us beyond the grave, beyond the grave. There'll be no more dying, no more crying, no more pain. When we put our live our lives alone, try to make it on our own. Let the past and the days remain. They will lead us to a land where the sun will always shine. God sent His only Son to fulfill the promise of the night. If we only believe, what a gift we will receive to live with Jesus beyond the grave, beyond the put our lives in the hands of Jesus. He will lead us beyond. When we put our lives in the hands of Jesus, He will lead us
beyond. Aren't you glad to know that for a child of God, there's something better awaits us?
Amen.
Better place?
Yeah.
No more pain, no more dying, no more agony, no more strife, no more headaches, no more heartaches. Hey, we could just preach right on from there this morning, but I'm glad to know that there's a place that God's prepared for us. Open your Bibles to the book of Judges, chapter 6. Judges, chapter 6. We begin reading in verse 6. Today, I'll begin probably a four-week series of teaching or preaching from the book of Judges in the time of Gideon. Today's sermon is God's call to service. God's call to service. Enjoy the quartet as they come to sing.
Christ a nation was charted long ago. Now the captain is ready and waiting, but the engines are still idle long, waiting now for those who still linger with unclaimed tickets free to every man. Salvation secured by the Savior. From this one-way flight to glory land, all aboard the Master calleth from the runway. For this one-way flight to glory land. Now this flight is for all those believing, and a pilot is Jesus, God's Son, and the passengers are all boarded safely. They're prepared for this heavenly run. My brother, don't let this flight leave without you, for soon all those who on board will say goodbye. Make your toll gate called Calvary and confirm your reservation to the sky. All aboard the Master calleth from the runway, for our leaving is almost at hand. Make your for this one-way flight to glory land. All aboard the Master calleth from the runway, for our leaving is almost at hand. Make your way to the toll gate called Calvary. For this one-way flight to glory.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. How wonderful it is to know that when all of this is over, all this is over, it's just beginning.
Yeah.
It's just beginning. I trust that everyone here today, when it's all over here, are ready to begin in eternity. But until that day comes, it's our glorious pleasure and honor to serve the Lord. Look with me in Judges chapter 6. Begin reading in verse 6. Call to service for God. And Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried unto the Lord because of the Midianites, that the Lord sent a prophet unto the children of Israel, which said unto them, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt, I brought you forth out of the house of bondage. I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, out of the hand of all that oppressed you, and drove them out before you, and gave you their land. And he said unto them, I am the Lord your God. Fear not the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell, but ye have not obeyed my voice. And there came an angel of the Lord, and sat under an oak, which was in Ophrah, that pertained or was owned by Joash the Asbarite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress, and hid it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, then why has all this befallen us? And where be all the miracles which our father has told us about, saying, Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Go this in thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewithal shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and am least of the father's house. And the Lord said unto him, Surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man. And he said unto him, Now if I have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. Depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee and bring forth my present, set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until thou come again. And Gideon went in and made ready a kid and unleavened cakes and an ephod of flour. And he put the flesh in a basket and he brought forth the broth in a pot and brought it out under the oak tree and presented it. And the angel of God said unto him, Take the flesh and the unleavened cakes and lay them on this rock and pour out the broth. And he did so. And the angel of the Lord put the end of the staff that was in his hand and touched forth the flesh and the unleavened cakes, and there rose up fire out of the rock and consumed the flesh of the unleavened cakes. And the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. And when Gideon perceived that he was an angel of the Lord, Gideon says, Alas, O my God, because I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. And the Lord said unto him, Peace be unto thee, fear not, thou shalt not die. And then Gideon built an altar therefore unto the Lord and called it Jehovah Shalom. Until this day it is yet an Ophrah of the Amorites. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the service thus far. Lord, for the singing and the music, how it's lifted our hearts to heaven. Lord, I just pray now, dear God, as we look into service, a message concerning service to you, our service to you, may we find a great example in this man Gideon. Holy Spirit, lead us, guide us, and direct us. Give us what you'd have us to have. If there's any that's lost, may they be saved. If there's any not walking where they need to walk with you, may they renew that walk today. And then, Father, Lord, edify the church and lift up and encourage the saints, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Our call to service for God. Gideon was called. All through the Word of God, you find men and women being called to particular service for God. Sad to say, but I have known many men and women who have lived in failure and lived life of sorrow because they missed the calling of God on their life. I pray it's none of you. I've known many men who have spent their life in a work, in a ministry that they were not called to. And the result of their spending life in ministry and work that they were not called to by God, it's been a life of ruin and a life of hurt for them and many people around them. God calls, anoints, and sends men and women for particular reasons, particular service. In our ministry today, or in ministry today, in Christian ministry today, there are many who are not called of God. There are many who are filling roles and pulpits and churches and teaching and preaching and various ministries that are not called of God. They're there for various reasons. And as one of my old pastors used to say, it's probably because their mama called and daddy sent. It's because somebody wanted them to be a preacher and they weren't. They missed their calling. But even sadder today, in today's churches, we find that there are many who are fulfilling these roles that are payday called. It's a preacher, what do you mean? They're there to get a check, basically, in ministry today, in churches today, all over America. You say, people are there for those reasons? Yeah, there's lots of people there for those reasons. Called himself, called by others, called by mom, called by dad, called by paycheck. You see, these people are in ministry for riches and for self-advancement, and they care nothing about the souls of men. I encourage you to check these ministries out. Go to wallwatchers.com or ministrywatch.org, and you'll see how many of these TV evangelists and TV preachers, both men and women, are making millions of dollars while deceiving millions of people. How sad it is. But it's not so with those that are called by God.
Amen.
It's not so by those who are called by God. Just as Gideon was, and we find by Paul's teaching in Romans chapter 11 and verse 29, when Paul says the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. What that means is God's not sorry that he called his people. He's not embarrassed about it. And they're there for the reasons that he called them for, to serve him in ministry daily as they walk with him. In our text today, we find that the nation of Israel done evil in the sight of the Lord. May I say today that they just simply an example of America and the church in America today? Israel done evil in the sight of the Lord, just as America and the church today is doing evil in the sight of God. And the result was, and it always will be, when we turn away from God and his leadership, God and his direction, and when we turn away from God and his word, there will always be bondage and oppression from our enemy, Satan. You say, preacher, it sounds like you're down on the church. No, I'm saying it's time that the church returns to God.
Amen.
The evil that's going on in America finds its place and its origin in pulpits just like this one here this morning, all across in America, and just like churches all across America, where people have decided that they no longer want to serve God. That's what's wrong with America. Don't blame it on the Democrats and the Republicans and the Libertarians and the Independents. Don't blame it on the White House and the Capitol building. Blame it on the people who are supposed to be God called who aren't, who are fakes and who are false in the pulpits today. But Israel's oppression and bondage did not stop God from working and moving in the hearts of their people. But in all of their oppression and bondage, they did what Christian believers need to do today. You find in verse 6, they cried unto the Lord. You say, Pastor, they cried unto the Lord. Yes, they found themselves in evil condition. They found themselves in bondage and affliction. Just as America's churches today is finding itself in bondage and affliction. And they repented of their sins. They cried unto the Lord. They said, Lord, why are we under such oppression? Lord, why are we here today in the condition that we're in today? And they repented of their sins and turned to God, and God will deliver them. My friend, the word of God is full of this teaching, repent or perish. Christ said that many times, repent or perish. Also, we find that it's God's will that all men come to repentance, none any to be lost. We find in verses 8 and 12, that when they repented of their sin, when they cried unto the Lord, that the Lord heard them and delivered them by sending a prophet or a preacher with a mighty hand to lead them out of their oppression and their bondage. What was mighty about Gideon? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. We'll look at his life in a minute and what he was doing. But why did God say that he would lead them out with a mighty hand? Because Gideon relied on the commandments of God, the leadership of God's angel that was feeding him what God wanted him to have. And may I say this, before there comes a deliverance in your life personally, in a church together, or in Christianity as a whole, God always sends a preacher with the word of God to deliver those people out of bondage and out of sin. So let's look at the calling of Gideon to service. Look with me in verse 11. We find a man in a fearful and helpless plight. One, but not only one, but the whole nation of Israel, but one God deals with in verse 11. And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under the oak, which is an Ophrah, which pertained to Joash the Abrazite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. Here we find a man, a young man probably, according to Bible scholars, they were living in caves. If you want to go back and look at the condition that Israel was in, they were living in places dug out into the walls of the mountain. And so Gideon had planted some wheat, he and his father, and they were threshing. He was standing threshing this wheat, harvesting this wheat in the wine press, getting the wheat off of the stalk. And he was taking that wheat and hiding it from the Midianites. Because you see, the Midianites would come through and take everything they had. That was the impression. If we're not careful today, the church and Christianity today is in a position where somebody's trying to come in and steal everything that we have. His name is Satan, and he's using politics to do it. So they were hiding. He was hiding everything that he was trying to save from the Midianites. Gideon is just like the picture of people today that live a life under the fear of men. Aren't that the way people are living today? Have you ever seen a time in your life and a time in America where people are as afraid as they are today? Fearful about tomorrow, not certain about anything that's going to happen, scared to death about what's going to happen in the political system of America, scared to death about the economy and system of America. And these people were the same way, and anybody that's oppressed of Satan and under the satanic bondage is in the same condition as people today as they were that day. May I say to you this morning that separation from God's ways, separation from the ways of God, from the word of God, from the commands of God, always will pervert the motives of life that should be lived for God. Anything that comes in your life that shouldn't be there is called sin, and it will pervert the life that you should live gloriously for God. That's what happened to Israel. They obeyed not the word of God. May I say to you this morning, that's what's happening in churches across America today. They obey not the word of God. As I looked at this, the question came to my mind. Why should the redeemed of the Lord be fearful in the face of mere men? Why should we as believers be scared, be fearful of what man is and who man is? I hear, and you hear, and we're going to hear it for the next year or for the next several months in this political season of presidential election. I'm scared of this, and I'm scared what this man is going to do. I'm scared what this woman is going to do. I don't understand this. I don't understand that. I'm going to tell you this. Don't be afraid. Let's be like Elijah. You see, the redeemed of the Lord should be as Elijah was in 1 Kings 17 when he said this, "And Elijah the Tishbite, who was the inheritance of Gilead, said unto Ahab, the wicked king, and Jezebel his wife, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain in these years, but according to my word." Is this not the condition of the church of America today? Is it not time that you and I, as believers of God, stand as Elijah said and take the word of God in our hand and say, this is what we're going to live by, and this is how we're going to live our life, and this is what we're going to conduct our lives by? Mr. President, whether you like it or not, Mr. Governor, Mr. Senator, Mrs. Senator, whether you like it or not, we're going to stand against the evils of government and evils of religion and evils of modernism and evils of liberalism in churches today. And we're going to take the old-fashioned, the perfect, pure Word of God, and we're going to guide our lives by it, and we're going to stand proud in America as believers. Amen. Isn't it time? Isn't it time that you and I quit putting on a face of doubt and a face of fear and an attitude of hopelessness and stand strong on the Word of God and say, God said it, I believe it, whether you believe it or not, but this is how we're going to rule our lives and this is how we're going to live our lives. If it had our lips, the devil, if it had our lips, every politician in America, if it had our lips, people around us, if they don't like it tough, we're going to stand for thus saith the Lord. Lift high the banner of God, present the Word of God to sinful men, that they might come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. Believers, if you're ready to stand for God and His Word, why don't you give Him praise and glory in His house? Not only did we find a fearful plight, as we find in America today, but whenever we find the church in trouble, and whenever we find Christians in trouble, we can always find that know for sure that there's a comforting message that God's going to send to His people. Look in verse 12. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, you might just hold your Bible there, we're going to read a few of these verses. The angel of the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. Think about that. Here's a guy, common everyday believer of Jehovah, just like you and I are common everyday believers of Christ, working our hardest to do our best to supply our family, to keep people from around us from stealing everything they got. Working for God, working for our family. And the angel of God comes and appears to him and he says this, the Lord is with thee, Gideon, you mighty man of valor. What a message. What a message that the messenger, the angel of God, preached to Gideon. Is it not the gospel of grace that he preached to him when he said, the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor? Just a common, ordinary person. May I say to you, if you are a believer of God, it's the same message that the Lord gives to us today. What a wonderful message. The Lord is with thee. How much greater can we expect? How much more blessings could we have? What a greater message could you and I receive than to say the fact that we love God and God loves us and the Lord is with thee? Is it not the same message that Jesus Christ gives to all of us who believe Him today when He tells us in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 20 in that great commission, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. Let it be so. Christ also says to us in Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Amen. What a greater message could we have? What greater encouragement could we have to know for a fact and without any doubt that God says, if you are my child, I am with you even to the end of the world, even until the day that you leave this world, I am with you. Amen. God said it. It's time that we as Christians believe it and live like we are. Empowered by Him. Think about this. Though the world stands against us, though the government stands against us, though politicians stand against us, though liberalism in churches stand against us, though churches are compromising on every hand around us, as we stand tall by the Word of God, it's not because we are mighty, it's because He that's within us is mighty. It's not that we're powerful, but it's because He that's powerful and the Word of God is powerful. And you and I can have this great blessed assurance that I will never leave thee nor forsake you. I'll be with you always, even to the end of the world. Should not we as believers obey this promise and do as instructed in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. I'm going to tell you there is no time for compromise. Now is no time for letting down. But now is the time that you and I need to take the message of God, place it in our heart, place it in our mind, and stand strong upon the Word of God. You see, the angel or the messenger that came to Gideon is just like the angel or messenger that is with us. His name is Holy Spirit, and he takes what God gives him and brings it to us, just as Christ said He would in John 16, 5. All things that my Father hath are mine, therefore said I that He, the Holy Spirit, shall take of mine and show it unto you. What a blessing the message is to believers today, that we have the power of the Holy Spirit. We have the presence of Almighty Christ living in us. We have the Word of God in its power. And we have the covering of the armor of God, that we might stand against the devil and his demons and the wickedness in high places, evil in high places, those who pervert the Word of God, those who stand against us. But if you and I as believers stand and have this comforting message from God that I'll never leave you nor forsake you, and we need to stand strong upon the Word of God. If you intend to stand because of the comforting message, giving praise and glory in this house this morning. So we found the problem is sin. They repented, got right with God. That's what the church in America needs to do today. Then we find the message to God's people, a great comfort. I'll never leave you. You see, the truth is this. We who know Christ know him 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, every day for the rest of our life. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. There's no reason that you and I can't stand strong on the Word of God, because we have the power of the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within us. We have the Word of God to God to arm us. But then there comes this question of great concern. Great concern. I've had people ask me this question just recently. I've had people ask this same question. Look at verse 13. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? And where's all those wonderful things that our fathers told us about? Why has all this befallen us is a great question of concern. Well, God had already answered that question in verse 1. Look back to verse 1. We didn't read it, but look back to verse 1. It was because Israel had done evil in the sight of God. All this came about because of one little three-letter word, sin. Sin. It came about because of the rejection of God's people to obey his word, the failure of God's people to obey his word. May I say to you, the word of God has not changed, because we still find in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 that the wages of sin is death. We find in James chapter 1 and verse 15 that sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. May I say to you that the evil that Israel done brought before them death. They went into 7 years of bondage to the Mennonites. They lost everything they had. They were hiding their foods just to have enough to feed their family, as Gideon was. May I say to you, things have not changed today. The reason the church is under the oppression that it's under, the reason Christians are being oppressed and being abused and being misused today, is because of sin in the camp. Somewhere in the near future, I'm going to preach on the sin of AI. There's sin in the camp. There's something in the lives of people that hides them from the blessings of God, that removes them from fellowship with God, as it should. And Israel had done evil in the sight of the God. They had sinned, and God said sin brings forth death. Destroys everything. May I tell you this morning, sin will destroy a life. Sin will destroy a family. Sin will destroy a church. Yes, sin. I've seen many churches that sin destroyed. Sin will destroy homes, and sin will destroy lives. But praise the Lord. He tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hallelujah.
You see, even in the sin of his people, God does not cast off or forsake those people of his, and he still loves them. Listen to what the psalmist said in Psalms 94:14. For the Lord will not cast off his people, neither will he forsake his inheritance. Neither will he forsake his inheritance. Why? Because he forgave our sins at Calvary. But we need to continually repent. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. But we as believers have a great promise from God. We as believers who occasionally catch ourselves where we shouldn't be. As a matter of fact, we ought to inventory our lives every day to make sure we are where we should be. John tells us this in chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. The Apostle John says this, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, We have fellowship one with another in the blood of Christ. Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. He says this. This is basically what John is trying to tell us. If you and I will walk in the light of his word is light. His word is light. If we'll walk according to the dictates and the teachings and the doctrines and the instructions of the word of God, it's light. The psalmist said it's light unto my feet and lamp unto my path. We find that we have fellowship one with another. You see, sin breaks fellowship. Now understand, sin does not break relationship. Even though Israel sinned, they were still their children. Even though God's people sin sometimes, they're still his children. But sin will break fellowship. It simply says this, that when you sin, there comes a curtain of division. That sin becomes a divider between you and your fellowship with God. And you have grieved Holy Spirit that lives and dwells within you. And that fellowship, that oneness is not there like it should be. It breaks fellowship in churches. It breaks fellowship in churches. When there's sin in the camp, and when somebody's living in sin or open sin, or when somebody's even living in hidden sin, it breaks fellowship. You see, that sin breaks fellowship with those true believers, those people who are living the way they should. It breaks fellowship in homes. Sin breaks fellowship between husbands and wives. When one sins against the other, that fellowship, they're still married, they're still husband and wife, but there's a fellowship that is not there. There's a joy that's left, and there's misery that's there. But I'm so glad that's not the end of the story. I'm so glad that's not the end of it. For it says this, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Now I know those people, and I know there's people today that preach and teach sinless perfection. And I know those that say they never sin. I've never met one that never sinned. According to the word of God rightly divided, there's never been but one man that ever walked on the face of the earth that didn't sin. He was God. His name was Jesus. So when you and I begin to deceive ourselves or to lie to ourselves, sin even becomes more wicked and sin becomes more perverse. When we say, oh, I'm saved and I can do anything I want to and everything I want to, and I can just simply know that God forgives me. No, no, no. The word of God still says that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away and behold, all things are become new. And the word of God still true in Hebrews chapter 12 said that if you be without chastisement, you're not his. The word of God very plainly puts it, if you be without chastening, then you're bastards and not sons. God chastens all of his children. So if we say we have no sin, we lie to ourselves. And God's truth is not in us. But if we confess, I love this. Listen to this. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Aren't you glad that God on the cross of Calvary made provisions that all of our sins were forgiven at Calvary? And aren't you glad that God in his foreknowledge and his great love and his great grace and mercy knew that we were still in this sinful nature, in this sinful body of ours, and we were going to fail and come short? And he says, all you have to do is get on your knees before me and say, Father, I have sinned. And I say, you're forgiven. What a great comfort. Amen. What a great blessing. If you love this great forgiveness and you know this great forgiveness in your life daily, why don't you give God praise and glory? Amen. And if you're here today and you're living with sin in your life, why don't you get on an altar and confess it? Why don't you get right with God? See, if you're part of this church, and I'm being bold this morning, if you're part of this church and you're living with unconfessed sin in your life, you're causing the break of the fellowship with the Holy Spirit in every meeting that we come to in this church. Get on, do yourself a favor and a blessing, and do your church a blessing by getting on your knees and getting that sin out of your life. But do it daily. Not only do we find a great question of concern, but we see now a great commission. Look with me in verse 14. And the Lord looked upon him, upon Gideon, and said, go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent thee? May I ask you this morning that maybe God is asking this church and all churches across our land that still believes in him, that same question. Go in this thy might, the power of the word of God, that I might save America from the hands of the devil. Have I not sent thee? Isn't that what Christ done? We'll look at that in a minute. You see, the Lord simply said to Gideon, go, for I'm sending you. Christ simply says to us, according to his word, go, because I'm sending you. Christ gives this to us, the believers, the same commission as he gave to others, because we find in John 15:16, he says this, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall ask of my Father in my name, he will give it to you. Christ also tells us in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20, go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. He says to Gideon, go, because I'm sending you. He says to believers today, go, because I chose you. Go, because I ordained you. Go, because I'm giving you a great commission. Go, teach them to observe all things that I have taught you. Isn't it time that you and I, as God's children, as he tells in Acts chapter 1, that when you receive the power of the Holy Ghost, you will be witnesses unto me, both into our local community and to our neighborhood and around the world? Isn't it time that as Christ has given to all believers the same commission, that we as believers should be given in praise and glory for his choosing us and his sending us, and be faithful in his command of going? Why don't we give God praise and honor that he has commissioned us with such a great commission as to reach souls for him? Amen. But then you always find this excuse. I see a common excuse that Gideon and all believers make. This is an excuse that all peoples made. Look in verse 15. And Gideon said, O my Lord, wherewithal shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least of my father's house. Moses made that excuse. Saul made that excuse. Or Paul, Apostle Paul, made that excuse. Hey, and by the way, so did I. And so did you at some point in your life. You may be making that excuse today. You see, our poverty and our weakness is no argument against the exceeding riches of God's grace and mercy. You can stand and tell God all you want to that I can't, and God's going to say you can. You can stand all you want to and say I ain't, and God's going to say you are.
Amen.
You see, God's command and God's commission has not changed. Make all the excuses that you want to. Somebody once told me that excuse was nothing more than the skin of a reason stuffed into a lie. So you say, God, I'm not able. He says, why not? I'm empowering you. You say, God, I don't have the ability. He says, availability is the best ability you can have. You say, God, I'm weak and I don't understand how to do it. He says, you go in my strength. Isn't it time that the Church of America today stop making excuses and realize that our helplessness and our in view of the all-sufficient God and his great powerful word just cannot stand as an excuse for not being in the service for God? Isn't it time that everybody that sits in our pews and whose names are on our church rolls began to realize that we need to stop making excuses? Get up and go, because God has said, get up and go. I send you. Truly, our weakness is one of the best qualifications for service. Paul gives us a couple examples of this. Listen to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. For you see your calling, brethren. Stop right there. For you see your calling, Harry. For you see you're calling Jim, for you see you're calling Jack, for you see you're calling Alfred, for you see you're calling Stanley, for you see you're calling Becky, for you see you're calling Sandy, for you see you're calling Nora. No, that's not what he said. He says, for your calling brethren, every brother, every child of God, How that not many wise after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound or confuse the wise. And if God hath not chosen the weak things of the world to confound them that are mighty. Who was Gideon? He was a Stanley. Who was Gideon? He was a Jack. Who was Gideon? He was a Curtis. Who was Gideon? He was just an ordinary person that God said, I'm going to use mightily. And I'm going to tell you this, every person that God calls, God saves, and God redeems, He wants to use mightily. And it's time that we quit making excuses for not letting God use us. Take the Apostle Paul again in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He had a problem in the flesh. Now, many people have made great remarks on what his problem was. I don't know. I have my own opinion what it was, but he had a problem. And he came to the Lord three times and said to the Lord, I can't serve you basically if you don't take this problem out of my life. Lord, I'm having problems serving you because I got a problem in my life. An infirmity. I don't know what it was. So he came to him three times and basically said the same thing. Lord, I wish you'd take that problem out of my life. You see, God don't intend for us to be problem free, by the way. And this is his response to Paul. And he said unto me, Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Most gladly, therefore, this is Paul now, after God gave him that answer. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in my infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecution, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. Isn't it time that church today, and isn't it time that believers today quit telling God, God, I can't because I got a headache? Isn't it time that Christians quit telling God, I can't be faithful to your church and faithful to your work and faithful to your word because I've got this problem or I got that problem? You see, earlier in the scriptures, we found where God says there's three people who made excuses. One of them even married a wife. There's no excuse that God accepts. None. But God says, Stanley, even with your infirmities, even with your problems, even with your things that's going on in your life, unless you follow me, you'll never know the power of God in your life. Unless you go where I send you and do what I tell you to do, you'll never understand and appreciate the power, the majesty of God in your life until you surrender and say, God, you said go, I'll go. Is it not time that believers stop making excuses and get busy in the service of God? If you're ready to stand and serve God, why don't you give Him praise and glory in His house? Amen. Because you see, only after we recognize our sin, repent, will we see the power of God, the commissioning of God. We'll answer the question of why. We'll have the comfort of the Holy Spirit. We'll follow His calling. We'll know His power. Will we know and understand the eternal promise that He gave us? Look in verse 16. And the Lord said unto him, surely I will be with thee, and shall smite the Midianites as one man. What a promise. What a promise when God says to believers that Christ is Lord, that we with Him are engaged in His service. Listen to these promises. Now listen to this. What a promise God gives to all believers who takes God at His word. When God says, go for I send you, get up and go in His power. Listen to John 1 John 4:4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is He that's in you than he is in the world. What a problem. What a promise. What a excuse knocker that is. Amen. Well, you see, I can't come and go visit because I'm bashful. Greater is he that's in you than bashfulness is in the world. I can't sing in the choir. Greater is he that's within you than all the music that's in the world. I can't teach a Sunday school class. Greater is he that's within you than all the abilities of education that this world provides for you today. Greater is he that's in you than all the demons out of hell that tries to stop us from doing the work of God. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 6, so that we may boldly say, listen to this, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. What a great eternal promise it is that God is with us. God is greater. If you have this eternal promise and you live by this promise, why don't you say thank you, give him praise, you Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
And because of God's promises and God's sending and Gideon obeying, we see in verse 24 a special place in the life of Gideon. We see an altar of peace that comes from being obedient. Look in verse 24. I want to read a couple of things here. Let me flip back. Look in verse 23. And the Lord said unto him, peace be unto thee, fear not, thou shalt not, what? Die. I underlined that. What a peace would that bring to your heart? Fear not, thou shalt not die. Then Gideon built an altar there unto the Lord and called it Jehovah Shalom, and is unto this day yet in Ophrah. Can you imagine the peace that comes from submitting to God and his call to service as Gideon felt? Can you imagine what the church could feel today if you and I and all believers would stand boldly upon the word of God? Can you imagine the peace that would come if the churches of America would fall on their face, as we'll preach sometime later, and confess their sins and repent of their sins and ask God to heal their land? Isn't it time that you and I realize the promises of God that says this? That no hurt and no harm can come upon those that follow him. He told Gideon, and we'll look at this more in the Sundays to come. Gideon, I've got a job for you to do. I want you to do. And Gideon says, Lord, I can't do that. I'm the least of my father's house. He says, Gideon, go because I said so. Go because I sent you. So Gideon went. Gideon surrendered. Gideon obeyed. And we find that he found a pleasant, a wonderful place of peace. Gideon built an altar and called it Shalom, Jehovah Shalom, which means Jehovah sent peace. Could it be in our churches today that there's turmoil and trials and not peace because God's people are not obeying the command of God to go? Could there be there's no altar of peace in churches today because we have said and we refuse to do what God wants us to do and there's evil in the camp? But when we go and when we submit, when we surrender to his will and we follow his commission, we find an altar of peace. You see, you and I, as all believers, have found that altar of peace at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. He was the final offering for sin. And all believers who come to him can know the powerful peace of God. Christ says to us in John 14, 7, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you as the world, not as the world giveth, give I to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Let me ask you this morning. Is there a place that you can say is an altar of peace in your life? Have you followed God's leadership and his command? Have you obeyed his commission? Have you took his calling to heart? You say, preacher, I'm saved. But I haven't been doing what God wants me to do. I haven't been doing what God wants us to do. I'm going to talk about this tonight. But in this little basket right here, on these little pieces of paper, there's 75 families in Martinsville and Henry County that we have opportunity to minister to. 75. I wonder if we have 75 people that would come and go see 75 families. God is calling us and commissioning us as never before to stem the evil in America, to stop the political rise of sin in America by starting at one church at one time, one believer at one time. I asked you, will you follow God's great commission? Will you surrender to His call in your life? How great it is to be called by God, to be in His service, and to be in the place that God wants you to be. Are you, as a believer, living a life of sacrifice and service to God? Or are you putting everything else in front of Him and not obedient to His call? And are you thankful for the peace that comes from being obedient to God? Amen. If you're here today, you don't know Christ as your Savior. If you're watching by TV or internet and you don't know Christ as your Savior, let me read one verse of Scripture to you. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Do you know Him? If so, are you serving Him? Are you serving Him to the fullest, or are we making excuses? May I tell you, based on the Word of God, God accepts no excuses. God expects full service. After all, He gave full service to us at Calvary. He gives full service to us every day with mercy and grace. Jack, would you and Gene come? Heads bowed and eyes closed. All over this auditorium, I preached the message that God wanted me to preach this morning. I know I've been in the perfect will of God in doing so. Now I want you to take time to inventory your heart and your life as a believer. Are you serving God the way you should serve Him? Have you surrendered to the commission that's on your life? You see, every believer is commissioned. Every believer is called, and every believer is sent. Are you doing what God wants you to do, or have you missed the call of God on your life? Have you missed the will of God on your life? If you are, you're miserable, I guarantee you that. Why don't you come this morning as a believer and surrender it all to Him? Why don't you come this morning as a lost person, give Him your life and live for Him? Father, take this invitation, use it for Your glory. I've done what You've asked me to do. Holy Spirit, move in the hearts of Your people. In Christ's name, amen. Brother Jack?
251. How is that?
Did you come?
Jesus is tender.